tires, raincoats and umbrellas are usually the first things teams pack before heading to the French GP, except this time out, MotoGP took the Spanish weather with it. From a surprisingly sunny Le Mans, this is After the Flag. Well, a show from Le Mans wouldn't be the same without the usual trip to the Monster Energy Party tent. You can probably hear the music in the background, but before things get underway, we're going to catch up with Bradley Smith. Bradley, thank you very much for joining us.
Welcome.
Today. These parties must be quite busy for you, quite a busy weekend. You've got to come along, you've got to do all the signing, maybe even pictures with the girls, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's a hard life.
It's a hard life, I know.
I can think of worse things, that's for certain. But yeah, it's a busy one, Le Mans. With Tech 3's home race, with Monster Energy being the title sponsor, it's certainly a busy one for me, but there's a lot of perks for the job. There's a lot of Monster girls around, and a lot of fans also, French fans, so a lot of autographs that need to be signed, and just a good atmosphere. I think, they're quite enthusiastic up here in the north of France, so it's always a pleasure to come here.
And do you reckon some of that enthusiasm may have come from the start of the season? Let's rewind back a little bit. Qatar, front row in the first race, and only in your second year in MotoGP. Was it a bit of a surprise for you, or were you that confident going in?
Well, obviously, we got the benefit of the 3 days prior.
Right.
So I think that gave us a huge step in front of everybody else. And also, I like Qatar. It seems to be somewhere that I get on with well, and seems that I've adapted well to that track. But yeah, to end up front row was a big shock for me. And to be able to be so competitive during the race, stay with the front group like I did, was a bit of a surprise. And I finally found myself there, and I was like, wow, podium's there, you've got to go for it. And so many people have gone, well, fourth was your best result up to that date in MotoGP, why didn't you settle for that? I said, it wouldn't be me if I was going to go for fourth. So. But I think that certainly started us very good, maybe a little bit too good, because everyone then the expectation of you doing that every weekend. But the last few races, we've been in and around our target of fifth, so I'm pleased.
I think one thing which I always try to bring across somehow on After the Flag is just how special MotoGP is, maybe how tricky these bikes are to ride. Now, but for instance, you guys don't use the clutch anymore. What's the main thing you've got to focus on to be fast out there?
For me, main thing is always brake point. Learning how to extract the maximum from the brakes, and judging that speed from that brake point to the middle of the corner without lifting the rear tire off the ground, without pushing the front tire too much, and being able to slow down enough speed that you then can release the brake and carry the speed through the middle of the corner. Now with the electronics and the level of MotoGP bikes, the kind of apex speed is very similar for all riders, and the acceleration is really masked from electronics and grip from the motorcycle. Okay. So there's only so much that you can do as a rider in that area. So now the key is coming to where you're braking and then how much speed you can carry from point A to then point B where the apex is.
Right.
And that's obviously a fine art.
But don't you find it somehow ironic that the main skill lies more in slowing the bike down, even though you're a racer and you're meant to be going fast?
Yeah, but That's the way that racing is at the moment, and that's why we see so many people working with ballast, bike balance.
Right.
That's why you hear so much bike balance, engine brake, electronics, because all of that is all making a difference. And sometimes I think I need to put a big sail out the back of me and slow me down like a Formula One car, have some downforce, but that's the fine line at the moment, and it's an art. It really is. It's still that feel and trying to, learn how much you can push the front into the corner that's not detrimental. I've obviously had my fair few crashes already this season, but that's all trying to figure that out.
But then is that also a little bit about body positioning then maybe? Because obviously we imagine you're pulling the front brake as hard as possible, no? And then leaning in. I mean, surely bike ballast, like you said, but it's, that body positioning. We see some of you guys dangling off with a leg out, some of you guys not so much. I mean, that surely has to be one of the keys, no?
That is the best way to describe it, is we are a third of the bike's weight.
Right.
So we are a movable mass of, let's say, 75 kilos.
Mm-hmm.
So if you move that 2 centimeters forward, 2 centimeters back, you rotate that a little bit further back, you rotate that a bit further forward, you move your head, from an axis point, if you move it away from the bike, compared to close by, if you sit on the bike rather than lean off the bike, all that makes a difference. And that's where, and also another art comes from, is learning what corner needs what, and also at which tracks, because let's say at some tracks you have really good grip and other tracks you don't have as much, so how you ride that, you know, that's all down to you to adapt to that thing. And the rider can adapt the best way possible. Sometimes you don't want to because you feel that you have your riding style and you'd like the bike to do it. But, you know, finally we're the best riders in the world and we have to adapt to that. And, yeah, remembering you are 75 kilos of a movable mass. Mm-hmm. Because the bike, you can only set it up. It's always still. There's a bit of dynamicness, you know, from acceleration and deceleration. Mm-hmm. But finally you can move on the bike. And, yeah, it's just positioning you in the right spot to get the maximum out of it.
Right, fantastic. Well, look, thank you very much. Best of luck for this weekend. And yeah, we'll speak with you shortly.
Well, it's quite hot here actually at Le Mans on Friday afternoon. He certainly would have been able to say that last year, and the last bike's just coming in after free practice. Particularly hot actually if you're wearing one of these, the rider leathers. And we're joined by Jeremy from Alpinestar.
Yes, Greg, yeah.
Very warm though.
It is, isn't it? Yeah, very warm.
Let's take a look at this and Cal crutched those leathers from this afternoon. Just talk us through it, Jeremy. I mean, they're quite heavy actually, aren't they?
Yeah, they weigh usually just average size for a MotoGP rider, just a bit under 4 kilograms.
Right.
But that depends really on the material that we make it out of, whether it's bovine leather or kangaroo leather. The kangaroo suit's generally a little bit lighter. Okay. Yeah.
So how many sets of leathers would the average rider have, more or less, over a Grand Prix weekend?
Most of our riders, MotoGP, Moto2, Moto3, will all have 4 leather suits for each weekend.
Okay.
It depends slightly on where they're at in their own particular racing program, but generally speaking, we try to have 4 suits available.
You've got zips as well here on the sleeve, so there's no way these could open it during a session.
No, if you look where the zip is, okay. if you try and pull that open now,
that's
it won't work.
So that
if
I will just, not open, no way.
If I just flip it, the puller up like that, then
it opens up normally. Right,
so
yeah.
these are locking zips to make sure that if the rider's sliding, it doesn't pull the arm open.
Okay. And are these quite tight though? I mean, on a hot day like this, are you not going to start feeling uncomfortable? And, is there any air getting in there somehow?
There is actually. The suit is fully vented, so it's got holes all over it at the front. The natural airflow as the rider's moving, you know, with the bike, pushes air into the suit. And actually on the back, there are exhaust vents down the sides and along the bottom. So we actually try and create a positive pressure through the suit to make sure there's lots of air going through.
Cal himself hasn't had an incident today, but we have seen a few across the opening couple of practice sessions in each class. That's a big job of Alpinestar as well, isn't it? Repairing crash damage.
It is indeed. We have a full technical service here, both staff and facilities. And in fact, I know some of the suits have just come back from the last session. So if you want to come and have a look, we can see what's going
on. Perfect. Okay, we'll head in then. Let's go and have a look at some of the damaged overalls and leather so far.
Yep. This is where all the work takes place during a race weekend. Our technical office with a technical team here doing repairs to suits, boots, and working on the airbag system as well.
Perfect.
The suit is made to measure. So at the beginning of the season, we took a lot of detailed measurements for Cal and created the suit accordingly. It's a print suit. So all of the leather is actually directly printed back at our research and development center.
Right.
Even all the logos, which means that the suit is nice and light and flexible. And also, the venting is also largely uninterrupted, so we make sure that, you know, it's as effective as possible. We have a unique system with external protection on the shoulders, on the elbows, and down in the knee area as well. Those are usually the key critical impact points when a rider goes down the suit. Yeah, and obviously the sliders are used all the time. But the external protection means that when the rider hits the track, there's a good level of protection to dissipate the energy all over the surface, and there's protection, soft protection underneath to absorb the energy as well. Also importantly, if they hit on the shoulder or the elbow or in the knee, which as I say is often the first touchdown point, then they tend to glance off the tarmac, and it prevents the suit grabbing the tarmac and pitching the rider into a roll. So that helps, all of it helps dissipate energy out of the accident.
Okay, well you mentioned there was a few damaged suits just come back from the pit lane. So let's have a look.
Yes, if you look behind you, Thomas Luthi obviously had a big off this afternoon. So you can see if I just pull the suit down here, you can see the kind of damage that the suit has to protect against.
I mean, that's taken quite a knock there, hasn't it?
It has, yeah. I mean, a lot of abrasion, beginning to pull logos off. Obviously, all of the polyurethane molded protector on the shoulder here is quite extensively damaged. Quite likely that that was an early part of the accident, just shows how important it is. But yes, the suit stood up well to the to the speed of the accident by the look of it.
Yes,
a bit of a hole in the aerodynamic hump, but then he's wearing a back protector underneath that, so shouldn't be a problem.
And here as well, Jeremy, we've got the Velcro strip, haven't we? So this opens up. Let's have a look.
Yes, this opens up, and Tom's airbag system would normally be housed in here. So the processor unit and
so
everything
like a battery
that goes
pack
with it.
And all that sort of thing.
Yes, a battery pack, and then the central processor, and then within the suit, there's a full body airbag.
So
that will keep him protected, you know, during the course of the accident.
I suppose the good thing is for Jeremy and the rest of the Alpine Stars team here is they won't be quite as busy as last year because it's not raining. So not quite so much damage to repair, is there?
Well, I hope so. Is that a prediction, Greg?
Well, it's a prediction more than anything. You'll know by the time the show goes out, but we'll see. Thanks very much, Jeremy. And try not to work too hard because we've had quite an exhausting few weeks, haven't we?
We have, but it's all good. We're enjoying the racing.
So the usual rain in Le Mans stayed away for race day, and qualifying had already shaken things up the day before with the likes of rookie Pol Espargaró on the front row. And the action already started here in turn one. Danny Pedrosa being touched by Bradley Smith, Nicky Hayden unfortunately being taken out by Andrea Iannone, and leading in the early stages, Andrea Dovizioso on the Ducati. Though he had Stefan Bradl and Valentino Rossi behind. Valentino Rossi already knew he had great race pace and soon managed to get past his compatriot. But one of the real stories of the day, Marc Márquez. Not the best of starts, we know he's not been starting well recently, but he then also touched with Jorge Lorenzo. That set him back as far as ninth place. But we knew he was quick. In qualifying, he'd already showed his pace, and then he mounted his fight back, was picking them off one by one, making his way up sixth place, fifth place, fourth place, third, then second, and then, of course, he had Valentino Rossi in his sights. Rossi, unfortunately, didn't have such a good battle with him because Rossi made a bit of a mistake letting Marc Márquez pass. And in the end, it finished Márquez ahead of Valentino Rossi, with Álvaro Bautista having an incredibly good race to finish third. And fourth place, Pol Espargaró, good mention there for the rookie. Danny Pedrosa and Jorge Lorenzo behind, not quite where we would have expected them, both with a few technical problems, but nonetheless, the championship has been shaken up a little bit, though only behind leader Marc Márquez, who has now won five out of the first five Grand Prix.
So the Márquez steamroller continues, 125 points from the first five races of the season, and it really is doing miracles in the championship standings. Let's have a look then at how things are panning out. Five races in with 13 to go. Márquez leading the way with that magical 125. 42 ahead of Danny Pedrosa. Valentino Rossi closing right in, just two behind Pedrosa now. In the meantime, poor Jorge Lorenzo, another disappointing race today. Fifth position still, but now 80 behind Márquez with 13 to go. So Qatar, Texas, Argentina, Jerez here at Le Mans, he's unstoppable so far this season. What about at Mugello in 2 weeks' time? He crashed there last year, but we're hoping for a better result in 2014. And it's Valentino Rossi's 300th Grand Prix. We'll see you at Mugello. Au revoir.